excited for the camp which is coming up. And this is something which is unique to us, and we have seen great times through this camp. So look forward to seeing all of you. I hope and pray that we will not, none of us will miss this session. And the second thing which I just thought that I will read out this portion, I hope Rakesh has mentioned to you all what will be happening in the coming month ahead. And he has told you about the last Saturday of October. You need to mark it and make yourself compulsorily available. Any travel, any schedule, I would say, reschedule and make yourself to be here on the fourth Sunday of. So what is it coming up? So I'm just reading up some portion for our encouragement. It says in Isaiah 43, since you are precious and honored in my sight, and because I love you, I will give men in exchange of you and people in exchange of your life. Do not be afraid, for I am with you. I will bring your children from the east. I will bring your children from the north. I will bring your children from the east and gather you from the west. I will say to the north, give them up, and to the south, do not hold them back. Bring my sons from afar and my daughters from the ends of the earth. So this is going to be a reality in our life, yet again in our midst, as we look forward to see the birthing of the fourth satellite unit of our being. So I just wanted to once again encourage, please, please reschedule anything which is coming, you know, disturbing this weekend. I would say that giving enough time so that we all should be there. I've been telling even back in Secunderabad and Kodaramasan, any schedule which is crossing with this, please reschedule so that you are available 100%. All of you ought to be there. Coming to one more thing which thought, which I know it's linked to the message as well. You know, this series which I have on with you for all the churches for some time, and ask God what is in it, in that mission, and you know, on mission with God, and we say living God's purpose for His glory. I mean, I think last Sunday, I think I was in Pocharam and through the worship, one thing which God spoke to me is this: when we are talking about living God's purpose for His glory, it means only this, that we bask in the shadow of His greatness. We don't have to do anything except to continue to bask in the shadow of His greatness. When we see the greatness of His, sang about His greatness through this the time of worship, when we are called to it, basically living God's purpose for His glory is those who have been chosen of Him is living or basking in the shadow of His greatness. He is there. It's all about the kingdom. Inevitability is about Him. It's never going to be anything concerning us. It's always going to be about Him. So our posture ought to be like, as it says in Psalm 91, He who dwells in the shadow of the Almighty. I mean, we are to be behind the shadow of the Almighty and bask in the greatness. And that is what we are the most about in our life as we live for God's purpose, for His glory. It seems very simple. We don't have to do rocket science to bask in, you know, continue to tell Him about that. But then we need to have that instinct in us to know that there is an invisible kingdom and it is inevitable. The advancement of the kingdom is inevitable, as it says in Habakkuk chapter 2, verse 14. Please, this is going to be, you know, at least maybe a couple of times more when I come, I'm going to be putting it on to you. Habakkuk chapter 2, 14, is about the inevitability of the kingdom, that the earth will be filled with the knowledge of the glory of God. Ask what has come, that is inevitable. Whatever force may come up against, it is not going to stop it. No force on earth will be able to stop this inevitability. And so that is our life is linked. Not having said that, let me also say a little to encourage you that, you know, we have been hearing about the persecuted, and Reshmi has been very faithful in keep posting that. I know it's serious, you know, it hasn't come, but that time out is not going to be there. Thomas also was intimidated, and he just got saved. In a miraculous way, God has saved him. Some time for day before yesterday, and I was telling him that if it was in a good time, then maybe that I would have been there usually, because whenever he was to UP, I'd be there with him in that context. So, the same place we have been going, the place called Sultanpur, when they were in the meeting, they came up about 15, 20 Badanda people, and they started questioning him, abusing him, and you know, kind of got close to him, and they, you know, confronted him and told him that you must tell, repeat after what we say. And they, you know, took their slogan, Jay. And he said, no, I will speak only what I want to speak. I will not speak what you want to speak. And somebody called for police, and police came and escorted from the police station. And they, bigger mob came with the media, and they said they had to be helped. Initially, first, they told the police, no, no, you don't need involved with this, we will handle it, we will settle this issue. They said, we will settle it, you don't need involved, you can go back. But the police by force took them to the station, and then came a mob with the media and all that. And then what happened? They kept persisting to fire the fire. There were witnesses stand by, tell them the police that, you know, they have offered us 25,000 rupees to, you know, convert to Christianity and all those kind of things. And police, at the wrong time, police took them with escort to the bus station, put them in the bus, and ran from this place. And they were able to get to the city of Varanasi and come back yesterday. He was back, and then I called up, he was telling that this word. So, you know, it is happening, but then when we see that, oh, you know, there is natural tendency for us to sit back and fear, no, it's not going to be, I'm not going to be in it. But then the fact is that what will be the forces which may be around, there is something called inevitability of the kingdom which they don't know a clue about. But can we rejoice in the fact that we have been given the knowledge of the inevitability of the kingdom to which we are called and be a part of it? That is the greatest joy for us. So let us continue on this mission this morning. On mission with God, living God's purpose for His glory, we are looking at the life of Moses now, preparing a people for all the people. Now, we are part of that. Now, along with kingdom inevitability comes a kingdom call. We also, you know, when we realize these are the truth we need to live for, we, you know, make our life become very easy. What is kingdom called for all of us? 1 Peter chapter 2 verse 9. For you are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people belonging to God, that you may declare the praises of Him who has called you out of darkness into His marvelous light. There is something called a kingdom inevitability to which you are called, a kingdom call. And then how it is been outworked? Ephesians chapter 3 verse 10. God's intent was that now, through the church, His manifold wisdom ought to be displayed and declared to the principalities that are. If we can keep these things at the core of our life and live in basking in the greatness of this God, I think we are, you know, almost living for God's purpose, for His glory. There is a kingdom inevitability, there is a kingdom God, and there is an outworking of this kingdom.
through us. It is not through anyone else. God is not about to create another generation. He said, we are that generation. We are that people God want to use
to declare the inevitable kingdom and His power and majesty through. So we have looked at Moses. We saw sometimes we, you know, can feel obscure in our life, and I'm going through this bad patch, nothing good comes out of my life. Wherever I put my hand, it turned out to be a failure. I blunder many times. These all things could be, maybe attract to God of our life. And Moses had that kind of attract to God. And here, in this point of time, he was in the wilderness 40 years. And as usual, he called it that he took his sheep out into the wilderness, into the mountain side for grazing. And we see that there was the unusual encounter with God that happened. We want to look into the lessons from Moses' encounter as it happened. It says that, one of the things which we looked at, we must make ourselves secure in our identity in God. All of us, it is very essential for our growth and for our stability and for our purposefulness in life that we must at all times be secure in God's identity. It's not what someone else thinks of you, it's what God thinks of you. Moses was muttering and muttering, Lord, who am I, Lord? He was not sure and confident enough. But then this is one thing we need to, for our progression in this great mission, living God's purpose for His glory. Number one, means we must make ourselves secure in our identity on God. Let the whole world say something about you, but then as for us, you are sure and you are confident that your God, your Creator, your Savior has called you by name and called you child of your mind. Are sure that you have, He has ordained the days of your life even before one of them came to be, and the love He has for you and the way He cared for you, that settles this issue. You can face the world and the majority with confidence at all point of time. Then we have looked at other aspects. Our faith in God must be developed steadily from crisis to crisis. This is something very encouraging. I see it as an encouragement for us. We can never, sometimes we say, our failure, what we see as a stepping stone into the success. We, hear about Edison, who invented electricity, and how many times he failed in this experiment, but he never gave up. But each of those failures has been a stepping stone into the real victory. So in our case as well, our faith in God must be developed steadily from crisis to crisis, as was the case of Moses. Moses has not become a man as we see in the Bible overnight. He had many failures, he had many flaws, he had many crises of faith. And that will be true for each one of us. We too will have many crises which we ought to go through in our life. And we need to turn those crises. Our faith in God must be developed steadily from crisis to crisis, as was the case of Moses. What happened to us after our burning bush experience is paramount in our journey of life. If after such an encounter with God, in an unprecedented way as Moses had. What is unprecedented in that experience? What is it there in it? There are four things which I would say that it happened. One is God shone His glory to Moses in the face of a burning bush which did not burn. Number two, God called Moses by his name and also revealed his name to Moses.
Number three, God revealed his character to Moses. Moses, don't come any closer. The place, remove the sandal from your feet, for the place where you stand is holy. He revealed his character and nature to Moses, and then God revealed his purpose for his people. I heard the cry of my people. I should take them to the promised land where I have, you know, covenanted in oath with your forefathers. So, in through this, that's what God's purpose was through that encounter. But then, after the encounter, as usual, Moses has taken the sheep back and went to sleep, having tired from the day's activity. I think nothing would have come up. But then, what happened to us after our Holy Ghost experience is paramount in our journey of life. That is very important. Do we leave it as something happened yesterday and keep looking back to remember it, or we live in the reality of that and allow that to, you know, shape the steps we take in our journey of life? And Moses spoke with God thereafter, and we see what unfolded in Moses' life. And lessons of Moses and God is faith and action is relevant in our journey with God, in God. Without faith and action, there is nothing called journeying in God or with God. Without faith and action, we can't progress without God. We will be stagnant. And this morning, we will continue to look to Moses' life and learn with some more things. You know, Psalm 103 verse 7 says, Moses made known his ways. God made known his ways to Moses and his deeds to his people. What would be your choice? If given a chance, you want to know God's ways or you want to know God's deeds? What would be your position? What would be your take? Something which we need to try. This is what is spoken about Moses. God made known his ways to Moses, and his deeds to his people. It speaks about something unique in God's relationship with Moses. And that, not of that relationship, we read again in Numbers chapter 13. There is a great comment about Moses. Moses was such a humble man, there was none equal to him in the face of the earth, in his humility. He was the model of humility on the face of the earth. So, we move on in unfolding through what comes next. Moses' life experiences, we are continuing to read on Exodus chapter 3 and Exodus chapter 4. We will not be reading into those portions. I would say that you must read. And what we are going to be looking at is how can, in the process of the journey of life, how can we become a people who knows his ways? How can we become a people who knows his ways? You know, we have this term called intimacy. We, many times, we relate this word intimacy with what? Are you having close intimacy with God? Having a quiet time? Are you reading your Bible morning and evening? Are you praying? Well, sometimes we relate. I know they are important to nurture our intimacy with God, but then I'm just going to bring out something more practical and action-oriented things in our life, you know, to permit us building up or becoming a people who knows his ways through intimacy. That's what we are going to be looking at basically this morning. So Exodus chapter 3 and 4. We have, last time we had looked at chapter 3 verses 1 up to verse 12 and 13 onwards. basically it's going to go from 30 onwards as we look today. We are going to unfold this in relation to what we have seen in Abraham's life, relating to Moses' life experience in that context. Number one, God chooses you to be on mission with Him to reconcile the lost world to Himself. God chooses you to be on mission with Him. To reconcile the lost world to Himself. And many times, as I said, we can have this tendency of hiding behind sometimes these weaknesses, these inadequacies, I don't have that skill set kind of reasoning with God. But then we forget the fact that it is God who has created us. He knows as well as to the skill set we have, as the skills and abilities we have. God knows it all. So when God chose Moses, He knew all of his weaknesses, even though Moses reminded him. Moses reminded God that Moses as if God does not know these things. First thing was, God, who am I? There may be many better people. Why you are picking me up? Then we go even further up. We have many excuses which Moses buildup can be seen. He had questions put up to God. What happened? Now you tell me to go. What happened if they don't believe what I'm telling? Then we go. He said that verse 10, chapter 4, verse 10, Moses says that, O Lord, I have never been eloquent, neither in the past nor since you have spoken to your servant. I am slow of speech and tongue. And finally, Lord, God is not budging. He said, Lord, please find somebody else. That is, leave me alone, Lord. Find somebody else. And we can be in that kind of a category, but then God knew that He would work mightily in Moses' life to move him from his weakness to strength throughout his lifetime, because He had chosen him. If you are chosen of God, which is true of all of us who are seated here, we have raised Him. We no untasted His love in that context. We need to know that God knows all about us. And if God has chosen us, we need to realize there is an end purpose to His calling, and He has chosen of us. Not take it lightly as a ticket to heaven. That's the primary thing I want all of us to know. When God has chosen us, don't take it granted. Oh, it's enough. I got my ticket to heaven. God chose you to be on mission with Him to reconcile the lost world to Himself through you. Through Moses, God wanted to prepare a people responsible for all the people, that this people will represent God or present God to the whole world. Now, all of Israel were going to be a kingdom of priests. We know that we are all going to be the kingdom of priests. So then if we are all priests, whom are we worshipping? He said that our worship ought to reveal to the people around, to the nation around, there is a great God. It was not for their comfort and convenience, but then it was to be for reconciling the whole world unto Himself. We see these little triggers sometimes happen in our hearts in the journey of life. Sometimes something which triggers in our life and we get burdened. Sometimes we get burdened with things to pray and in the seat before God. It may not happen to all of us. Maybe many different things happen to each one of us, but then we need to see that as this significance of we being warmed up by something of a thought or something of an incident in the purview of our life happens and we have been caught up with that, we need to realize that yes, it's something God outworking into our life. Are you praying for God to work in a specific situation, in your setting, in your life, in your home, or in the setting and society where you are in? God is absolutely determined to regain His kingdom through that thought which is kindled in your heart. But then we need to give ourselves. We should not stay back after the burning bush experience, but we need to move in faith and action towards this, and we see unfolding of that happen. And this is the strategy that God revealed to Moses, that He has chosen you to be a holy priesthood, as we keep repeating it every Sunday after Sunday. And I would say that this means to remind ourselves, I am a holy priest. I am specially chosen for a task. So that task involved reconciling the world, allowing God to reconcile the world to Himself. That God uses each one of us. Many times we fail it, and again, something unusual happened to us yesterday. There's a family came in home. They came with much inadequacy in themselves. They called me up and said, Pastor, can we come to pray for you? And they came in the morning. They can't speak, he can speak, his wife can't speak proper English. But they came with their Bible. They had an encounter with God in the reason. They were going through struggles of various kinds in their life, in their marriage. And they, have the touch of the Spirit in their life and they want deliverance. And they are bubbling with joy and they are beaming with joy. And the moment that I happened to share what is happening to man, and he said, can we come to pray? I said, we know we are coming. We are coming with much trembling because we know that we are coming to pray for a pastor. He knows much better. I know I felt great for a while, but then, I know what my state was. But then I said, please do come. I got so encouraged by their innocence and their simplicity. Whatever has been revealed to them, they have been born Christian. The sense, first generation, they have been, born to a Christian family. But they said, they don't know anything about Bible. All these things, they knew nothing about Bible. They said they haven't given much thought about the Holy Spirit ever in their life. But then having encountered the work of the Holy Spirit in their life, they are set on fire now. They had a burning bush encounter with God and they don't want to leave anytime. Let it be anyone, let it be anyone in their way, they wanted to pray. They gave and told us all the testimony of their life and they said encouraged us from Genesis, they encouraged us from times. They read the Bible. Why do we need the Telugu? I need from the English and they prayed for us. How many of us, challenge, how many of us are encouraged to do that? When we are called to be a holy priest, it is not just about being here for the Lord's Sunday, but it's our Lord is there on the outside into the world. And they said they are doing it just for the first time and they felt so comfortable because I made them comfortable and they were so I. I said, if my people whom I'm speaking week after week will get the message across and act the way they have done, we have greater stories to share and talk about. We are the link when it comes to the inevitability of the kingdom. And for that, we need to realize that we are on a mission with Him. Lord, partnering with Him to reconcile the whole world to Him. Number two, God calls you to Himself to be on mission with Him. We'll be going to elaborate on this. God calls you to be on mission with Him. Now this is where I want to bring that would we desire to be a people who knows His ways or want to sit back to know the deeds of God and oh yes, God parted the Red Sea. Wow. And we can read all that, but then it's something else to know His ways. The number one, I would say, the ways of God, when we look at, has to be this. Way of God is this. He takes ordinary things and ordinary people and does extraordinary things with Him. Our journey of intimacy begins with God when we do this in action. That is, allow God to take ordinary things in our life, ordinary skills and ordinary abilities as we have, and ordinary people as we are, and allow Him to do extraordinary things. When we read Exodus 3, read a part of it, and the only one thing God greatly used when God using Moses, you know what? What is the ordinary thing a staff, the shepherd carry around? The staff. The ordinary staff is the ordinary thing which God used for extraordinary thing through the lifetime of Moses. Everywhere God intervened, God used Moses' staff. An ordinary thing. And after all, what else can a shepherd can have as an extraordinary thing? He needs only a staff to, you know, wait the sheep in direction to the pasture. And as most ordinary, who am I, Lord? I'm just an ordinary person. Are you willing to give to God the very ordinary things? What will be what you consider as ordinary in your life to offer to Him, and that He will use it for extraordinary things? We need to realize this. He cannot, or He will not show His power in our life only to have a sullied reputation with contempt or indifference or fear or complaints. We can't hide behind this inadequacies and the ordinariness of our nature and skills and abilities and say, Lord, no. We are partnering, but that's what I said. We, in this journey of life, our God is to bask in the shadow of this greatness. He is great. What He wants is, are you willing to bring the ordinary thing you have in life and use it for the extraordinary things as it needs to be? You know, God is not seeking any leaders. God is not seeking any leaders while He calls His people, because He is the leader. He seeks servants who will be, you know, who will let Him lead. In our life, we need to be on that posture. What would be the capacity we function? We need to know that He is the lead. He is the deal. Part of the team. And that's why God told Moses, when He said, Lord, I am in this kind of, you know, kind of this ordinary person, He said, He knew. That's why He told him, yes, He wants people with that heart, that humble, that humility. Lord, God has been great thing from me. I'm shaking my knees when I stand before you. That's what God means. And that's where it all builds. Having abilities to lead is not important, but knowing who the leader is and letting him lead is quite good. And that is the important thing which we need to live in by in our life. So he takes the ordinary things in life and uses it for extraordinary things. For that, it requires an act from our lives to offer the ordinary things in our life. So we begin a journey of intimacy, or we begin to understand His ways when we learn to trust God with our ordinary things and with our ordinary life. He is not wanting you to be an extraordinary person with extraordinary caliber of skill set. No. He wants you just to be an ordinary person with ordinary skills. But then we need to be willing to obey and offer that small little things we have. Moses was willing to give God that ordinary stuff, and God would throw it down. And what happened to the stick? It became a stick. Do you expect that to happen? There is sometimes we need to learn to trust with God with the ordinary things, for God to the extraordinary things. It's not what you conceive what to be happening. I don't think Moses either believed that it's going to be turned out getting out to be a snake. But that's where God has to be allowed to work His ways in order to pick it up. And what happened? He picked it up. So here comes, we need to learn to give back to God whatever He has given us, and He will use it in the kingdom in an extraordinary way for His glory. So number one, He takes ordinary things. That means we want to offer the ordinary things in our life and allow God to do His extraordinary things through our life. Or I would say in another way, to become a people who knows His ways, we learn to trust God with our ordinary things and ordinary life. Number two, way of God is this. God expects you to obey His instruction whether they make sense or not. We are quite intelligent people many a time. We become super intelligent and we have many nonsense God. Moses also could have. I don't know if you have ever tried to pick up a snake. What did God tell Moses, having made this stick to a snake? Pick up? How? By its tail. Anyone with little common sense will not do it. Why? Because if you take the snake by its tail, you are sure to get a bite. And Moses has lived his half of his life in the wilderness. He can lecture God, Lord, what are you talking to me? I've seen it many times. But then you asked me to take it by the tail, and then he could have. You know, sometimes it's like this. God expects us to obey His instruction, whether they make sense or not. Sometimes it looks foolish. After foolish, you make a fool of yourself in front of all the people. But then, in God's sight, you are making yourself an instrument which is willing to obey Him. Number one, He asks the ordinary thing. Number two, He says, I may ask you to do things, it may not make sense to you, but then I want an obedience. Now we believe many times. We are not willing because we have this, whatever it is, God has given this something called our mindset, which and to defend us. Don't get into that foolish thing. You know, it speaks to us before even a thing happens and makes us think twice. Should I do it? I'm going to make a fool of myself. like David. It was such a shameful thing for a king to do. He would be presenting himself in his majesty and greatness with a royal robe and the crown on his head. But he said he stripped himself half naked and dancing quietly. But many times for us to become a people who knows his ways, it is when we apply this into our life. The second thing which I would say is, we begin a journey of intimacy with God when we develop a heart to obey God even when it doesn't make sense to our logical mind. When it's not make logical sense and still we are willing to obey God, is a step more forward in becoming a people who knows his ways. Number three, moving on, I'm not giving you a reference as well, I said Exodus chapter 3 and 4. Number three, way of God is when you obey, things won't turn out as you thought they would. Now we move on in chapter 4. God gave Moses three miracles as an evidence to prove to the people that, you know, he has met God and it is God who has sent him. Now here again he says that, Moses, put your hand in your cloak. Now take it out. What do you expect? And Moses had a shock of his life. He has expected his hand turned leprous, white, snow like white, and total, his hand has become leprous. And again, that's a big hope, a thought for us. When you obey, things won't turn out as you thought they would. I'm putting you into little, you know, sticky wicket in all these things. Because God's call is that we all become a people who knows his ways. Not that, you know, people read about great deeds of God, but that to become a people who knows his ways. I would say this. Be prepared that when you obey things based on God, I know you are obeying, you know what is it happening. What is it unfolding before me, Lord? It's not necessarily what you want to see will unfold. Are you ready in such situations? You know, when God spoke to us about our coming to Hyderabad, God spoke to me in a clear vision when I was driving. And, you know, he said that I was just moving into a newly repaired flyover, and I was one of the first one to move in, and God said to me, son, this is it. I'm taking you on a journey on a new highway. He said, Lord, exciting. And I spoke, and immediately one fantasy was overtook me. And, you know, the newly constructed property lifted up so much of dust, I couldn't see what is ahead of me. And he said, imagine while you become like this, you find it going too difficult. You would come to a point of giving up, stopping, but don't stop. In a little while again things cleared up and I was being led to a scene of a meadow of green. That is, I will lead you into. You know, many times when we, you know, take some time with much difficulty, the step of faith, we want to see what we want to see. Lord, I want victory, I want success, I want, you know, all those kind of things is what I want to see. But then say that when you obey, things won't turn out as you thought they would. I would say point number three as this. We become a people who knows his ways when we obey God and see the unexpected unfold. Are we willing to see the unexpected unfold in our life? Or we want to see only, Lord, what I can take, what I can conceive, or what is comfortable for me, what will make me happy, what, you know, put everything in safe and secure environment, that is what I want to see. No, it may not be. It may not be But then there is, we need to walk through the sticky areas of life that, you know, we must be willing to offer those ordinary things for God to use. We must be people who obey instruction, whether it makes sense or not. You know, that's why I find it very easy when it comes to, you know, in the Navy, in the service, there's one room. Something has been said, you better obey. You can raise, even if you have a question, you can raise a question after your obedience. So, it's not like I've been tuned to that in life through my service. God has prepared me 15 years in the Navy for this, in that context. So, many times it happens in our life that we take things seriously, when we want. We have an expectation, but then we forget that He has a greater expectation of us. Sometimes we allow our expectation to overrule His expectation. No, no, Lord, I don't want that. We step back and things close. We break the progression of the journey after the burning bush experience when we say, when we are not willing to take these things forward. When you obey, things won't turn out. They're not as you thought they would. So, we begin a journey of intimacy with God, or I would say that we become a people who knows His ways when we obey God and see the unexpected unfold. How many of us are willing to see the unexpected unfold? I know. Unexpected itself is a term which we don't, you know, I'm not very comfortable with. We heard, you know, and when we open the road, you know, if an unexpected, if there's a policeman's hand, you have to go by what is happening. Then sometimes it goes in that measure. But then know His ways. You want to be willing to obey God when the unexpected unfolds. God uses our obedience to move us into what He is doing. When we are, you know, break us from the shackles of these things in our life is that, you know, we are being led by God into what He is doing. You know, sometimes when we obey, things get worse. Start praising God. Like Paul and Silas, listen, you know, there's no way. I was telling Thomas, I was saying, when it's looked like God has led you out, like, quicker than Paul. I mean, that would be, but then, first we need to internalize the situation which we are. Thank God and praise God for that. Number four is another challenging one. God tells you just enough for you to know what to do next. God won't tell you the story fully, but tell you, man, this is the step. This is where you are focused. Next step. If they told you, then you only do that. God has told Moses these three parables. Short this parable, you throw the stick down, it will turn out to be a snake, and you pick it up, it will be back to your spot. And he said, put your cloak in your hand, you cloak and take it out. And he showed another parable and put it again and took it out. It will turn out to be normal again. And then he said, if they don't believe any days too, he said, you take some water from the night and pour it out, it will turn out to be. But the God has told Moses about the 10 plagues which is about to follow. God has told Moses about the parting of the Red Sea. God has told Moses about you touch a rock and I will make sure the water will flow out. God has told Moses about the manna and the quail which He will rain down from heaven. But Moses was still called to take the step of obedience. And that's where, many a time, the challenge happens to all of us and we become stagnant in our life and, you know, become people who are shunned in their connectivity with God. Because we are not willing, because we allow our imagination and expectation to walk beyond what God has thought about And when both are not connected, then it's bad that we are not able to progress. So, in line with what Moses, in anointing his way, these are the things which I would say we can pick it up, and this would be. This goes far beyond our quiet time and reading our Bible and 20 times of prayer, but then this looks about an actual life, even in the midst of uncertainty as them for. Moses was willing to take the talent which has come upon him, and he saw about how I would say he has become a man who knew the ways of God because of this. He was willing to offer the ordinary things. He was willing to obey and see the unexpected happen. And thirdly, he was willing to forego what will be the outcome, but that he was willing to obey. And fourthly, he said that God dealt with just enough. He was willing, Lord, once upon that time, I'm fine. But then even me and guide me. You know, that's where the intimacy clicks. We can be glued on to our Bible day in, day out. We can have our regular quiet time and prayer time and all that, but yet we can still miss out in knowing God's ways. If you think only that be a way of intimacy and not an actual life with what we live out. So we begin the journey of intimacy with God when we are willing to act on what is revealed to us. You know, we sin one day at a time. That's a good step, a good way of living. One day at a time. Bible amply exhorts us, don't worry about tomorrow. Our main concern is tomorrow, not how we live today. We think about tomorrow more. Don't you want to bring to another aspect in this regard? God moves in unprecedented ways all across the world. What God has done to Moses was an unprecedented act. But then, I would say that don't always ask God, I'm not seeing a precedent in my situation like what is narrated in the Bible, so how will I know? Not necessarily for you to have a precedent in your life for you to align with God. Or say, God, let me have an unprecedented encounter with you, then I will know. All things which happens around, world is enough unprecedented to give you unprecedented of you and all. Combined, it gives you a lot of unprecedented things which is happening. You know, recently there's come CD, they brought out a small summary of what's happening in one of the UP villages. They have come to know that this village, almost everyone has come to become Christians. And they want to know the truth. And they went, sent a team to the village to inquire about what's happening. They went from home to home. And you see the video, it said everyone is boldly proclaiming. They will not let go of Christ who has given them life, who has healed them, who has comforted them, who has been merciful towards their life. Unprecedented things are happening, numerous, in our own courtyard. But it's not, don't link your walk with God to have an unprecedented thing always to happen to you. In the face of all these unprecedented things happening around you, and also in line with what is happened to Moses and the narrative which he said, it's not right to ask God, Lord, let an unprecedented thing happen to me, then I think you will be missing out in God's plan. Don't wait for hurting. I'm not seeing an unprecedented thing like Moses or like that is happening in the village. Ever happened to me, then how do I know God is calling me? God has called you, there is a kingdom called for each one of you. Don't shy away from God's kingdom called for your life. You are a kingdom priest. Don't shy away from your role to reveal this great God to people around you. God will ask each one of us to do an account of what we did with our life. That's why we need Abraham. Through Abraham, God wanted to make a people who will become a blessing to all the people. He did not want Abraham, God, I shower you with blessing upon blessing upon blessing. Abraham, enjoy it for your lifetime, enjoy it for the next four generations. No. His blessing has come upon Abraham so that he can become a blessing for all the people on the earth. When we look through the life of David, David was telling, I am coming against you in the name of the living God. And by defeating you today, His glory will go across all the people. It is not between, you know, the main thing in Israel and Philistine. He said, this incident and this victory of this little meager boy defeating a Goliath, it is not about being a boy and Goliath, but it's about the greatness of this God. His greatness will be going across. And even now, that is being revealed. David and Goliath's story is one of the, what's king kind of a thing people love to hear about. And whenever we hear speak about David and Goliath, we are speaking about the greatness of this great God. And that's why we should limit ourselves into coming into the sphere of limelight in this journey of life ever. Only possibly we can take is bask in the shadow of His greatness and continue to reveal Him through the blessing which is flowing through our life and through the act of revealing Him to everyone else into our life. A covenant of promise and obedience with you. God makes a covenant of promise and obedience with you. You know, God, then once He said, He said that back on what He said. Always wanted to see that. When He was talking about deliverance of Israel, He was telling Moses, you know, Moses, sometime back I told Abraham, I promised them that I will take them to a land which is promised to them. God initiates a covenant of promise and obedience with you. God took a long view of the covenant He has made with Abraham. We can read it in Psalm 105 verse 8 to 10. And this will help us to focus on the fact that the driving purpose of Exodus was God's covenant and His determination to fulfill it. We can't take His word for granted. God never goes by on His word. The key to understanding the Bible and what God is doing is in the same is to understand His mission. People are free to do as they will. God gives us that option to us as well. We are free to do as we will. But God works in all situations to lead people to His ultimate purpose, to be acknowledged as Lord of all. Why the deliverance of the Hebrews? What is the reason for this story? It was that the name of the Lord be proclaimed in all the earth. God wanted the world to know Him and glorify Him. And God was preparing the strategy for that. You know, Egypt was one of the powerful nations. When the nations around Egypt will come to know these slaves which have been under the oppression of Egypt, they have left Egypt, or rather God delivered them. You know, it is going to bring in awe in the nations around about this great God of the Hebrews. God worked things out in that measure. And that's what God works as well. Number four, God prepares you for His mission. God prepares you for His mission. Because of His promise to Abraham, God began seriously to prepare Moses for his task at the burning bush by revealing his nature. And God is revealing much about him to Moses. God revealed him that he is eternal. The fire was unquenchable fire, and it was not burning the bush. God was revealing himself to be eternal. That he is the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And by revealing that he is the God of Abraham and Isaac and Jacob, he was revealing that he's a personal God. And God demonstrated his faithfulness by telling them he would give them their promised land. His faithfulness, God is a God of faithfulness. He reveals himself to you. Not only as a holy God, he reveals himself as a personal God and as a historical God, but also he is an everlasting God. And you know that Moses' preparation for many challenges is to face. It was not an easy success story for Moses. He has been set back 10 times by Pharaoh. No, I will not. No, I will not. Moses didn't come back. People have taken that 10 failures. In spite of this great wonders, that great wonders and miracles he has performed before this great king, pagan king. He did not move. People have gone, what has God done? Then people have given up. But have made himself, thought of himself as an utter failure. Lord, all this in the yet he is not willing to change his heart. Moving on, number five, God sends you to the place where he can best work through you to accomplish his mission. If God wanted, he would have just sent Moses and told Pharaoh, man, go. God wants this. He wants you to release his people. Why Moses go one after the other to 10 times? There is a reason to it. Why? He says, God wanted to bring down all that which Egyptians were holding on to. Through these 10 things, what God wrote down was all the deities and all the gods which Egyptians were. They, God wanted to undisputedly prove to them, those gods are no gods before me, and I still am the great God. That's what God was wanting to do, to do to him. And to do that, you know, it says that if Moses would have stayed by, Lord, nice experience today, thank you. And let's say the next day morning he woke up and said, come sheep, ba 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 ba, let's go to the, he would have not walked. Moses has moved from the wilderness into a place where God wanted to use him, in the palace, into the presence of the king. So we need to be actively sensitive in our life as to what God is doing in our life. We need to be very careful in the context of this. Moses could not stay on the backside of the desert and still go with God. God moved him to the place he could best use him. God sent Moses to Egypt so he could move his people to the promised land. It can be related to us as well. You know, we are standardizing ourselves, right? We are sending some people to Manipata. We are, you know, setting apart some people and saying, you be there and you build there. You know, we need to see and be willing to see the things that God wants to do through us. And if you say, no, Lord, I'm comfortable here. I don't want to leave my close friends. And there means again I have to start look for friends and, you know, build a fresh, finding new friends and building with them. No. That's in alignment with God's purpose. If you stay where you are, it may not work with sound form the way God has planned for your life. That's why the room. Number six, God guides you on His mission. God guides you. I mean, I've also stated that those steps of, you know, unfolding miracles of the 10 plagues. And it was God's guidance, in a way, ripping, destroying every path and every mind they held on to as Egyptians. And God's guidance was there for Moses to display that wealth. You know, He was working on Moses in that day. And He was making sure that by that, He was making a lasting impression on the life of Israel. Israel wasn't now when they were looking at all this happening, not for them, but on the other side, where the Egyptians live. And they looked at themselves, there's no fight, there's no war, there's no, nothing is happening to them. But then, when they kept looking at what's happening to the other side, it was increasing, and it was building their faith as well on this great God. So they are going to be embarking on a mission, on a journey within the next town. And lastly, number seven, it says that God uses you to bring glory to His name through His mission. The final act of God's deliverance from bondage was about to happen. And in the night they were living, there was wailing and crying all over Egypt. And suddenly, Pharaoh realized what has happened again. And it is after the people who left his country. By then, God, his people have come under the shelter of God. God had guided them and leading them by the pillar of fire in the night and pillar of cloud in the day. They were led by God and they parted. They got part of the Red Sea and passed by. God waited for the last people to step out of the Red Sea and to allow the water to sweep back across over the Pharaoh and his clan and the people whose was pursuing after his people. This was the last day and God's glory of deliverance on the life of Egypt, on the life of Israel. It's so encouraging when we read, but then there's no purpose if we don't apply that into our life, and that God is calling us on a mission. Work it. God is calling us to live a life for His glory. And it's required for us to know His ways. And know His ways, we need to become intimate with Him. In faith and action, within full through our life, can only that happen. Are we prepared to move on mission with God? Are we prepared to be people who knows His ways rather than heard about his deeds. The difference is here. God's desire for us is that we become a people who knows his ways and that will.
Let's look to some of the reflections and experience for us, points for us this morning. Are you praying for God to work in a specific situation in your life around you?
Mind you, God is measuring something in your heart. Don't neglect it. Don't neglect it.
Do you recognize his kingdom of God in your life and are you struggling with it?
You know the kingdom of God, you know we repeat it after every Sunday. The kingdom of God is there, but then are you struggling in your walk for the kingdom of God?
Something which you need to look to.
Provide the four ways God revealed his ways to Moses, and then you know that it is not just understanding his kingdom God, but that there is a step of obedience, faith and action which is there in our life. We need to check back. Is faith and action missing in our life?
Number three, to be allowed to be told his story, to benefit from his blessing, to participate in his goodness. God for a commitment to his purpose.
Are you there?
Are you ready to give back to God what he has given you, or are you wanting it back?
God uses our obedience to move us in what he is doing. But then we need to ask ourselves, am I obeying? If you're not obeying, you're stuck. You're stuck.
A precedent may not exist for what God calls you to do.
Are you ready? Don't ever fall back there. God, I'm not seeing an extraordinary thing happen in my life.
Then how do I know? How do I step forward?
It may not be personally happening to you. Unprecedented things are happening all around us in our backyard. We need to be willing to listen and we need to be willing to observe, see those things that could be made the effect of God is still at work. God never sleeps, most of us. He is always at work.
So don't wait. God, please do to me like what you did to Moses.
And I'm not doing it to you, but so many of such things are happening around you. Is that enough for us to trust in this God and move on in our life?
Just what God has to be people who know his ways.
It means we are journey with him on his mission. It means that we are living a life for his glory, living for his purpose for his glory. That would be us as we do that. Second is prayer.